Well, good evening. Good evening to you, family online family. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are at our New Year's Eve service, and I am joined by Pastor Janice on this evening. Welcome, Pastor Janice.
Thank you so much for having me with you on this glorious evening, Pastor Joy. It is truly a pleasure.
That it is. Listen, we are missing a couple of people on tonight. We want to shout out to Sly Stone on tonight. Sly King,
Stone. That's all right.
Sly King on tonight. Listen, we know that you are out enjoying your family and your time away, so we just wanted to shout you out, brother, and Deshondra as well. She's usually holding it down here with us as well. Does a phenomenal job. But online family, we're so glad you are here. You have time to just go ahead and like, tag, and share this broadcast. I promise you, you are in for a treat on tonight. This is actually our second service, so we've already talked and said we're not going to do any spoiler alerts. We're going to hold it until the talk back, so make sure you come back after this pre-show so that we can talk about your aha moments and your takeaways from today's service.
Yes.
Listen, if you are a first-time guest joining us for the very first time, we want you to go ahead and let us know. We want you to reach out to us. Text DECISION to 844-892-4888. Again, it's 844-892-4888. We want to hear from you. We want to connect with you. Go ahead, and if you're watching us online, type in the chat. Let us know where you're watching us from. We have viewers from literally around the world watching us and are a part of our family. And so welcome. We are here at our Derby campus. So welcome to our Bessemer campus and our Anniston campus as well. And to those of you who are watching us from around the world, we're so happy to have you on tonight. Pastor Janice, would you please tell us how we can get some prayer on tonight?
Well, I'm glad you asked. We are always ready, willing, and able to pray for you. Whatever you stand in need of today, tomorrow, next week, next year, anytime, we are ready to pray for you, with you, to lift those prayers up to God so that he may know what your heart is, and in turn, the Holy Spirit reveals what his will is over your lives. If you will, please call this number if you desire prayer. 1-833-789-2543. Again, 1-833-789-2543. And someone from our magnificent and wonderful and well-engaged prayer team will be more than happy to send up prayers to heaven on your behalf, that the Lord may receive them, answer them, and deliver exactly what his blessing is, in confidence and knowing he's going to meet whatever need you have wherever you're standing this evening.
Absolutely. And listen, family, you don't have to wait until the end of service to call in to the prayer line. You can call right now. You can call during service. You can call after service. They are diligently standing by, waiting to hear from you.
Waiting.
Amen. Listen, we have a lot of things coming up in this new year, and so we want to talk about a couple of those things. One of the things we have going on is our small groups is coming up. So we want you to get prepared to register for small groups. In fact, Bishop has a new curriculum that is coming out, and it is titled Go After It. Go After It. And so that is going to be one particular small group that we will focus on.
Yes.
Also, we will have our life group, our Living
awesome.
In Freedom,
awesome life group.
Everyday life groups as well. So those will be the two small groups that we will focus on. And for a moment, I just want to take a second and talk about the importance of small groups. What have small groups meant to you, Pastor Janice?
Well, small groups mean a lot to me. Previously, back in the old days, I thought that, you know, when we started doing small groups, I thought it was just something, you know, to occupy my time or do something else that I didn't really feel would give me much value. I thought it was just a way of engaging in something where there would be other people, but I wouldn't benefit from it, and I didn't think that they would benefit from me being there. But I've come to recognize that there is fellowship and community and support with small groups. I wish that I had started them a long time ago so that I could be further along then than where I was then, and now where I am now. I kind of held up my progress. So I ask you not to allow the things that I'm communicating to you to happen to you because you don't see the value in it. It's a great value. I know that when we did life, it just it created such a great bond with me and the other ladies, even as attendees and as leaders of the life groups. It will change your life phenomenally. You'll be blessed so much. You'll wonder, well, I think I ought to start a small group myself. Why don't I just try to do that? And you can't imagine how many lives you will affect by being obedient to doing the small group and changing the lives of people and the relationships that Absolutely. Those people have with other people when you engage in any of our small groups. So we welcome you to please participate with whatever avenue that we're offering the groups, and they will be virtual. Some people are doing them, you know, in areas where you can come into a physical place, and right. those settings are kind of quaint and nice also. Of course, we'll do the social distancing thing and make Absolutely. Sure that everybody is safe. We want to keep everybody safe with everything that we're doing here at the Worship Center.
Absolutely. And what I wanted to say about the small groups is that it kind of makes the big church feel smaller, you
yes.
know, because like you said, those relationships are formed and fostered in a smaller setting, and you begin to know one another.
This is
know.
True.
You learn that. I think that's, in fact, how we've come to know each other.
It is.
Small,
yes, it
small
is.
Small groups, and then you recognize these individuals when you're in the sanctuary and you begin to speak and you continue to do life together.
That's right.
And so I can hear some of you saying, online, you're like, I don't know about a small group. I'm not comfortable, you know, sharing, or I don't want to share. But listen, just come.
Yes.
Take that first step.
Please.
Just come if it's your very first time. And then for others, it may not be your first time. You may have actually been a part of a small group, and now God is calling you a little bit higher to maybe even lead a small group. There's one other thing that's coming up. Pastor Janice is going to mention to you about the 21 days of
yes.
prayer and fasting.
Yes, we will have our 21 days of prayer and fasting coming up really soon. It'll start January 17th and end February 6th. So I want you to decide what you're going to give up, what fleshly things you're going to give up for God in order for you to move into a position where you're sacrificing things for him so that he may deliver his word to be true to you, to bring you, to catapult you to a different place, those places that you've been trying to go without him. Once you get into that place and you submit to his will and let your flesh be crucified like Paul's was, God will continue. Even though we don't see it sometimes, he's doing it. He's working behind the scenes. He will continue to work out things for you that you will become a better person, a better servant. You will impact the lives of other people because of the things that you've done, because of the time that you've spent with him. And this is something that he honors every single time that we go before him, praising him, worshiping him, praying, reading word, reading scripture, anything that we can get a hold to that's related to God, it's going to bless somebody else because we were obedient.
Right.
To what the Spirit said for us to do. So I urge you to please,
yes,
please do that.
Go ahead, prepare your minds for the 21 days of prayer and fasting, and prepare your bodies as well. You want to begin detoxing. We'll be doing the
oh, yes.
Daniel fast, and there will be resources online to talk to you a little bit about the Daniel fast that will be taking place during the 21 days of prayer and fasting. So we hope that you can participate. And one reason we fast is because we want to starve our flesh and
yes.
feed our spirit.
Yes,
and there are some things,
man.
So many things that happen on the backside of our fasting. So we want you to be prepared to participate. Family, listen, we are getting ready to go into praise and worship. We want you to go ahead and like, tag, and share this broadcast. You still have time to do that, but you are in for a phenomenal time of worship and praise as we get ready to transition into 2022. Let's give God our very best praise. Listen, we love you, and we want you to join us in worship.
Yes, and you guys probably need to put your seatbelts on. You need to buckle
Absolutely.
Up because this is going to be a word out of the world. It's going to convict you. It's going to convince you.
Phenomenal
it's going to allow
worship.
You to know that God is tugging at you to do the things that he's called you to do. You're going to be on cloud nine when this sermon
yes.
is over this evening. So get ready, family and friends.
Make sure you come back and talk back with us immediately following the service. We want to hear about your takeaways and your aha moments. Family, let's go into worship.
somebody give God the glory. All over the building, stand all over your feet. Listen, as I'm watching that video, I said, now, Lord, I can sing a little bit, but if I could sing, y'all would have to tell me, say, turn the mic off. Come on. How many of you are just grateful? God, thank you. Thank you for watching over me this year. Thank you. Come on. You've been giving Alabama all your love. Give it to Jesus. Come on, give it to Jesus. Jesus is the one that kept you all year. Jesus is the one that provided. Jesus is the one that gave you the provision you needed, a roof over your head. Come on, somebody. There's somebody under a bridge right now that wish they had the house that you're going to pull back up to. God, I thank you that there's food in the refrigerator. Thank you for the word. Thank you for keeping me. Thank you for keeping my family safe. Thank you for keeping COVID backed up off our doorstep. God, I give you the glory. Come on, all over the building. Give him the glory. Through the ups and downs, Jesus has, we have found him to be faithful. Listen, on behalf of our senior pastor, Bishop Moody, and his lovely wife, Dr. Ty, and the entire worship center family, we want to say welcome to you tonight. Welcome online, wherever you're joining us from, all over the world. God bless you. Do us a favor online. Tag and share. Get your family members in and say, listen, you don't want to miss this. Listen, if those of you kind of sneaked in at the 5 o'clock service, you know that God moved and it was an amazing time here in the building. We give God the glory. Listen, here in the sanctuary, on the seats in front of you and around you, you'll see a QR code, and that code is a one-stop shop for all things TWC, for prayer, for giving, for joining this amazing church, and we want you to take full advantage of that. Listen, we are getting ready to go higher into worship. How many of you know the group Virtue? Come on, somebody. Virtue. Oh, come on. They showed out the first service, and we expect nonetheless now. God is getting ready to move. I want you to prepare yourselves and be expecting in this service to hear from God and watch what he does. Amen? Amen. God bless you. Now. Stand on your feet if you're not standing. Put your hands together. Give God glory for Virtue.
Redeemer, saving grace. God is so awesome, is he? Praise God.
Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? And who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Well, I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer. Redeemer.
Thank you, God.
My name is Heather.
Ooh. Give me a minute.
That's Karima.
That's
and
Karima.
My name is Ebony.
Catch my breath. Yes. Karima.
And we're so happy to be here to worship with you, to bring in a new year. We're so happy to be able to sing and be on a stage again and see people. God is so good. Thank you, Bishop, for affording this opportunity us to worship with you guys and to for you and your beautiful family and your wife and your kids and everybody here. And I know we gotta go on a time schedule, so thanks for having us. Keep worshiping with us. Amen.
Ooh, thank you, God.
Undergirded me,
you lose the chains and remove the shame. You kept my mind from hurt and pain.
Yes.
Lord, I thank you.
Lord, I thank you. Lord, I
Lord, I lift my hands, I bless your name. I look back and see where you brought me from. Through the good and bad, you remain the same. I praise your name.
So many tears fall.
Style of delivery is captivating, funny, and knowledgeable. He provides lots of laughter along with a guaranteed message on being a better you. His motto for his brand of comedy is laughter is good, but the message is better. A three-time college graduate with an associate's degree in fine arts theater, bachelor's degree in radio, TV, film, and master's degree in communications, Marcus is also a published author. His book, Hustle and Faith, remains a top-selling piece of literature, and excerpts from the book are often quoted from the pulpit to the streets. Yolanda Adams refers to him as a comedic genius. Radio mogul Kathy Hughes has called him a modern-day Dick Gregory, and Chase and Charlie only see him as dad. He's been married to his wife, Erica, for 23 years. Let's give a big welcome to the one and only Marcus D. Wiley.
What's up? How y'all doing? All right. That's good. Yes, good. It's good to be here. I want to start off just like this. We're in a pandemic still, and when it first hit, I didn't think it would tarry this long. You know, I thought the pandemic would only be about 2 weeks. Churches was calling me to perform when the pandemic first hit, and I was real arrogant at first. I was saying stuff like, nah, I don't want to do no virtual shows, you know. My career has taken me too far to be doing that, you know. I was very confident in the beginning because I had money saved for a rainy day. And then around July, I realized I didn't have rainy year money. So I had to start accepting some of these days. Now, one of my homeboys, y'all, he's on the club circuit. He travels and do the clubs, and he asked me, he said, hey, Mark, since the churches are closed and the clubs are open. I said, since the churches are closed and the clubs are open, you can come feature for me on my tour. And so, you know, I ain't really want to do the club scene because a lot of folk, when they see a Christian in the club, you know, it vexes your spirit. And so I didn't want to mess y'all up. You know why y'all in there? I didn't want to mess you up by me being in there. And so, you know, I was like, man, I don't know if I want to do this. And then all of a sudden, I went home and I heard a still voice. And the voice said, who can we send? Who will go to the clubs for us? And I said, send me, Lord, I go. And so this whole pandemic, I have been on the club circuit. Now, listen, I want to let you know, if you teetering, if you thinking about being in these clubs and not these churches, don't do that, because there's no place like the churches. There's no place, no treatment is better than the churches. The churches have fantastic hospitality. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Y'all, when the churches book me, they fly me first class. Yeah, first class. That's where you sit in the front of the plane. Yeah, first class. I know some of you think exit row seating is first class. No, it's not. That's just more leg room. First class is all you can eat, all you can drink, and all you can drink. Some of you know the difference. Nevertheless, watch this here. But when them clubs book you, man, listen. I had a show in Dallas at the Dallas Improv. Now, from the trip from Dallas to Houston to Dallas is 25-minute flight, 3.5-hour drive. Why did I have a layover in Afghanistan? Who booked this ticket? Is this Travelocity? Okay, when them churches booked me, y'all, they put me up in five-star hotels, that's where they have valet, they have concierge, they have gift shop, they have room service. Five-star hotel is where your room is on the inside of the building, on the inside, yeah. But when them clubs booked me, they put me in inns. It was no room for Jesus at the inn. Why they want to put me in there? Inns brag on stuff that just come with hotels. Inns always bragging on stuff like, we got free Wi-Fi. So, you know, we got airport shuttle. Okay, so, yeah. Inns is where your room is on the outside of the building. That's when they come pick you up. They just drive the car all the way up to the door and flash the lights. And you move the curtain. A lot of our leaders would still be alive today if they lived in hotels and not inns. Last but not least, I love doing the church because when the churches book me, they pay me with a good check. A worship center check has never bounced. This is a check I never had to worry about. Yeah, I've never had to worry about it. Yeah, your tithes and offering, thank you. Yeah, I really love doing the white churches too, because they give you all your money before you even show up. They really believe in God. I mean, they step out on faith, you hear me? Don't you ever pay a black man all his money before he do the job. I'm lying to catch something. I can't make it. Yeah, but them clubs, they give you a check with instructions. You ever receive one of them checks? Somebody give you a check and be like, say, hold that till next Thursday after four. You be like, no, I ain't got paid yet. But yeah, the thing about it, I'm in the clubs and people kept coming up to me asking me stuff like, hey, I didn't know you did clubs, you know. I thought you was a church a Christian comedian. And, you know, I ain't never really liked the terminology or the label of Christian comedian. I mean, I am a Christian that happens to be a comedian. Christian comedian just sounds stupid to me. It's a lot of you Christians out there, you don't put the title or the label on your occupation, okay? Ain't no Christian pest control company. We only kill saved roaches. No, it's the unsaved ones I need you to kill, the one that's flying around. Ain't no Christian firefighter. You know, we only put our saved fires. No. Yeah, so I really never liked that. People in the club kept coming to me, man, I thought you was a pastor. Like, I ain't no pastor. Now, my dad's pastor, my grandfather pastor, my great-grandfather pastor, but I broke the generational curse. Won't he do it? Yeah, I broke that. But yeah, it's some reasons why I can't be a pastor, though. You know, I looked at that. I can't be no pastor, man. You know, that's why you be thankful for your pastor, because you should be just praising God that I'm not your pastor. It's four reasons why I can't be your pastor. Yeah, first reason why I can't be your pastor, and I don't want to offend anybody, but until they allow cussing in here, I'm not going to be able to pastor. Yeah, I'm not going to be able to pastor, because some of you all, you need to hear it the way I want to say it. You know, I'm not a cusser, but I know how to cuss. You understand what I'm saying? And my daddy, I remember him coming home mad. Ooh, I wanted to cuss Deacon Joe out. My mom would be like, you should have. Now you're coming home making our house a hell hole. You should have cussed Deacon Joe out. Got it off your chest. Second reason why I can't be your pastor is because y'all do too much walking in church. It's just too much walking. Church folk walk nowhere else, but you have a freedom, a liberty to do a bunch of walking in church. Never like that. If you go to, let Frankie Beverly come to Birmingham. Huh? Frankie Beverly come to Birmingham, you get to the concert, all right? You done passed 15 restrooms, ain't thought about using it. Because you got them jeans on. And you said, ooh, I can't take these off till I get home. I know how you think. Yeah, I ain't going to take these off. So you just up there the whole time, Frankie, there. You just doing your thing. No problem. But only in church. Soon as pastor say, turn to Deuteronomy. You can't even find it on your phone. It was different with the Bible. On the phone, you can't find it. Then you want to do this here. Want to put the number one up, thinking this make you invisible. You're not invisible. If I was a pastor, I want to preach with a bowl of rocks right here. I dare you to get up while I'm preaching. I dare you to get up. No, go on, get up. You got to use to get up. Either you or these rocks gonna cry out, but get up. I dare you to get up. Yeah. Third reason why I can't be your pastor is because I can't keep your secrets. Christians got juicy secrets. Christians have extra crispy secrets. And do you think I'm gonna risk my good health? Huh? Risk all type of ulcers and migraines and hypertension holding on to your sins? Huh? If I'm your pastor and you tell me something in a counseling session in privacy on Wednesday, just know Sunday when I get up here, that's church business. Y'all say we're a family church, right? Well, we about to see. Last but not least, reason why I can't be your pastor is because I like to go out too. Oh, I'm finna break every chain. I said, I like to go out too. And I just don't think it's fair that you, the congregants, get to live your life any kind of way. And I got to be at home fasting. I got to be at home praying, trying to get a word together for your raggedy life. That ain't fair. That's why if I was your pastor, you'd be downtown Birmingham kicking it at a party or something, you'll look up, Pastor, praise the Lord, everybody. I'm in there with you. Yeah, I'll see you in the morning. I'll see you at church in the morning. I got a word for y'all. Man, the pandemic, let me go here, y'all. The pandemic, watch this. The pandemic it's been highs and lows for me during the pandemic. Highs and lows. A lot of revelations came out the pandemic, you know. One of the ones came out the pandemic, you know. You found out that a lot of women were not cookers. They were fixers. You know, because when everything shut down, you know, we couldn't leave at first. And so it separated the cookers from the fixers. Yeah, you found out a lot of folk fix. Like, you fix tuna fish. You fix hamburger helper. You fix tacos. A lot of men talking about, ooh, my baby cooking tacos tonight. No, your baby fixing tacos tonight. Cooking requires something, you know, being sauteed, something being smothered, something being stuffed. Cooking is when you preheat the oven on 350 for 2 weeks. That's cooking. Is it ready yet? No, not yet. Yeah. Another thing was, let me say this because I'm married, I'm grown. My wife was all on me during the pandemic. Yeah, she was all on me. Stay with me. She was all on me, and you know, and I thought this was strange because, you know, I was like, hey, come on now, calm down. You know, you tripping, and she was just coming in there all like, ew, I got something special tonight. Like what? You know, we've been married 24 years, and if you got something special tonight, why have you been withholding it this long? That's what I want to know. I mean, what you got so special tonight? But watch this, it got so bad, we had to do a Kelsey Seabowl, that's a clinic, a virtual doctor's visit, because I ain't lying, it was bad, it got bad, and so I asked the doctor, I said, hey man, I said, my wife, whoo, tripping, and so the doctor say, hey, Mr. Wiley, this is very, 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 very common, because men typically peak, you know, in their 20s, and women don't get started until their 40s. And so I ain't gonna lie, I just shared my wife, you know, I said, hey, listen, you know, since you sick, we gonna have to change some things about our relationship. No, because he diagnosed her with this little thing, a condition called insatiable. And insatiable mean can't get enough. And I've had enough, you understand what I'm saying? Okay, I'm gonna get out there. I'm gone. I'm gonna get off of it. But don't act like y'all ain't married up in here. Don't get all tight. I ain't the only one. But watch this here. But I end up getting a ministry in the pandemic. I got a ministry. Watch this. God gave this to me. He gave it to me, Bishop. Watch this here. God pushed me forward. Let me show you. A lady DMs me and says, hey, man, I would love for you to counsel me and my fiance. I hit her back. I said, I am not a counselor. She hit me again. She said, hey, I listen to you on your radio. I love how you talk about you and your wife relationship, and I think me and my fiance can really benefit from your wisdom. I hit her back again. I said, ma'am, I am not a counselor. She DM'd me the last time, Dr. Ty, and said, I'll pay you. Now, who am I to block the blessings of the Lord? Huh? He did this. I ain't do this. I ain't asked for this. So I go home. I tell my wife, I said, babe, a lady want me and you to counsel her and her fiance. My wife gonna look at me and say, you ain't no counselor. I said, Satan, get thee behind me. You gonna be the main one wanting the purse. The main one wanting the pair of shoes. This gonna pay for that. So anyway, y'all, we get into the little old Zoom counseling session, me and my wife right here, and I ain't gonna lie, the lady started crying. She's talking about, you know, her and her fiance, we've been engaged for 5 years, and I was like, whoa, that's woof. I was like, now 5 years, that's a long time to be engaged. I mean, either y'all gonna get married or y'all not. I mean, I really wanted to tell her, he ain't gonna marry you. It's been 5 years. But you know, I wasn't led to say that. And so while she crying, I'm looking, I'm like, oh Lord, I'm, you got me out of here. You know, I ain't got no degree. You know, I ain't got no certificate for this. But she finally said something I could latch on to. She said, and you know, when I listen to you on the radio, I just want my relationship to look something like y'all's. And that's what I got. I said, hey, first of all, you want your relationship to look like me and her? I said, first of all, when you hear me on the radio, I'm lying. That's not real. That's theater of the mind. Me and this girl had an argument before we got on this Zoom. Yeah. And I had to tell her, I say, look, if y'all ever do get married, marriage has its own set of fingerprints. Stop trying to make yours look like somebody else's. You got to learn to say stuff like, watch this here. My relationship ain't on this relationship level yet. Don't mean it won't get there. You just not on it yet. I close with this. Y'all, show you what not on that level yet mean. I work on staff at a church. I was married 3 years at the time. Another man was there. He was married 25 years. He said for lunch, he's going to take his wife, get a brand new Lexus. They're going to go to lunch. He's going to come back to work. We said, cool. He got back after lunch. We said, hey, how did it go? He said, oh, man, she loved the car. She's just so happy. Soon as he telling us, his phone rang. He answered the phone. Hello? She, I crashed the car. He, what? I wrecked the car. He said, are you all right? She said, the car is total. He said, babe, are you okay? She said, I don't know what happened. I didn't see it. It just messed up. He said, hey, I don't care nothing about that car. Are you all right? I said, wow. My relationship is not on that level yet. Because had my wife called me 3 years of being married, I wouldn't ask her, is she all right? I know she all right. That's why she called. Why did you get in this wreck? Probably putting on lashes, trying to beat your face. Hey, y'all, that's my time, man. I'm Marcus D. Wiley. I appreciate y'all. Happy New Year.
Impossible. I want you to look at somebody next to them and repeat this after me. Tell them, don't miss it. Something bigger is coming. Look at somebody else around you and tell them, whatever you do, don't miss it. Because something bigger is coming. Romans chapter 1 and verse 17 says that the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. It means that more of God, more of who He is, and more of what He desires to do in my life and in your life is revealed from faith to faith, which means that God sets up our life to work in such a way that we are moving, whether you know it or not. God has ordained it so that we're always moving from one level of faith to the next. But this journey is not a steady incline. It's more of an increasing kind of stair step. So as you move from faith to faith, it's not a steady incline. It's kind of like an increasing stair step, meaning that you experience a peak, but then you go into a valley. Then you experience a higher peak, but then you go into a valley. Then He takes you to a higher peak, and then you go back into a valley. But God pulls us into the valley because He wants our faith to grow. He wants us to be shaped because He knows that on the next peak, something bigger is coming. And all of us are going to have to go through valley, the valley to go to the next peak. But what I need you to understand tonight is that if you are going to get prepared because something bigger is coming, you've got to know, number one, that there will always be a process. I think I lost some of you because you don't like to hear this about the process, but I'm coming. I want you to understand that Jesus is our pattern for how God will work in our lives. If He did it in the life of Jesus, then guess what? He's going to do it in your life, meaning that God will intentionally take you through the process. Because the process is preparing you because something bigger is coming.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Hello. Praise the Lord, everybody. Here we go. They say these mountains can't be moved. They say these chains will never break. But they don't know like you do. There is power. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There's so much power in your name. So much power. Still an empty grave.
For there is still an empty grave.
Oh, God, we believe.
God, we believe no matter what.
There, tell them.
There is power in your name.
And you make it real so much.
So much power in your name.
God, we believe.
You'll see a miracle.
Hey,
God, we believe.
God, we believe.
God, we believe for it.
Hey, how many of you believe in miracles? How many of you believe? somebody believes. Yeah. Listen. You are the way when there seems to be no way. We trust in you, God, you have the mind of say. Everybody say.
You are the way.
Come on, y'all. Cause you have the final say. Tell me you are the way.
You are the way.
When that
seems to be the way.
Hey, hey, hey.
We trust in you.
Cause you have the final say. Believe in God for something that you know you cannot do for yourself. That God is doing something not just for 2022. We're talking about 2023, 24, 25. Come on, somebody's looking for healing. Yeah. Oh. Cause you said it. I believe it. You said. From your heart, tell them it is done. One more time, a little louder. Claim your victory. You said it. Tell them it is done. One more time, help them team, you said it.
You said it.
I believe it.
I believe.
You said it.
You said
it. This is it. It is done.
It is done.
Now, if you believe it's done, clap your hands and say, yes, God. We bless your name, Jesus.
It says, that day when evening came, he said to his disciples, let's go over to the other side. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. And a furious squall, that's a storm, came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. And Jesus was in the stern, or the bottom of the boat, sleeping on a cushion. And the disciples woke him and said to him, teacher, don't you care if we drown? He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, quiet, be still, is what the NIV says. I'm used to the King James that says, peace, be still. What I want you to see in this passage is I want you to see the big picture, and I want you to see the bigger message. This story and this passage, please get this. It's a picture. Somebody say picture. It's a picture of how we can have peace in the midst of storms, and it all revolves around the Word of God. So I want you to get this. I want you to get this. The Word is directing them. The Word is anchoring them. The Word brings peace for them. I want you to get the picture. They're fighting the storm. The storm is raging, but the problem is they've allowed the Word to go dormant in their life. So in order for them to get peace, while the storm is raging and they're busy trying to do their thing, in order for them to have peace, they have to go awaken the Word. Without the Word, I need you to understand, nothing new can be created. Without the Word, nothing can be put back together. Without the Word, no fresh wind will come into your situation. All of this happened through Jesus, who is the Word.
We are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is God's power of salvation. Everyone that believes, oh, everyone that receives it, we shall have everlasting
And so God says to Joshua three times, be strong and courageous, be strong and courageous. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Because it is your time. But what God is saying is that prophetically, I know what's up the street. Prophetically, I know what's up the road. Because God knows that pretty soon Joshua is going to come into contact with a strong city called Jericho. And God gives Jericho, gives them a strategy for Jericho. He says, here's how you got to handle it. It's going to be unorthodox, but it's only for the mature. When you get to Jericho, for 6 days, you got to walk around the city once a day. But then on the seventh day, you got to walk around seven times. So the first time they walk around, God doesn't do it. The second time they walk around, God doesn't do it. And if you are into God having to do it quickly, and that's all you know how to pray for, then when God doesn't move as quickly as you want him to move, those kind of folk get frustrated and disappointed. But the folk that God is looking for in this season are not just people who can pray for, but people who can pray through. Meaning that if he doesn't do it the first month, you're still fine. If he doesn't do it the second month, you're still good. If he doesn't do it the third month or the fourth month or the sixth month, you still will serve. You still will pray. You still will praise. Are you following me? There comes a time when you've been praying through something that you got to stop and shift over into just praising him for it, even before it comes to fruition. Walk around it 6 days. But then on the seventh day, walk around seven times, and then here's what I want you to do. When the trumpet sounds, I want you to shout. Just start shouting. People may not understand it, but just start shouting. People may call you crazy, but just start shouting. Because there's something about praise. When you praise, there's something that happens. What do you mean there's something that happens? Well, it's been scientifically proven that if you take sound and you take sound up 700 octaves, sound becomes light. Light then becomes energy. Energy becomes mass. Mass becomes matter. So God says, what I need for you to do, Joshua, is I need you to be mature enough to not only pray when everybody else is sick of praying, but I need you to praise when folk don't feel like there's a reason to praise. Because if you make the right sound, sound becomes light. Light becomes energy. Energy becomes mass. Mass becomes matter. So when folk keep talking, Bishop, about what's the matter, you're focusing on the wrong thing. The issue is not the matter. The issue is your sound. Because if you make the right sound, you can change the matter. This is why God says if you just praise, stuff will begin to happen. I wonder if there's anybody in this room tonight that doesn't mind giving God a shout of praise up in here.
Come on, lift those hands and tell God, thank you for the rain. Come on, lift your hands or lift your heart and tell God, thank you for the rain. Yes. How many of you know God is going to do great things in your life, in your children's lives, everybody that you know? Here we go, team.
I hear the sound of revival deep in the hearts of your people. Send it now.
We want it.
We want it now.
I hear the sound
of revival deep in the hearts of your people. Send it now. We need it now.
One more time. the sound.
I hear the sound of revival deep in the hearts of your people.
Your glory.
Release your glory.
Send your glory, Lord.
Send your glory.
Tell them we're hungry.
We're hungry. We're thirsty for you.
We want you.
We want.
How many of you want the Lord today?
We're patient.
We're waiting.
For you.
We need you.
We need you.
Tell them we're hungry. Lord, we will wait for you, 'cause all we want is you. Lord, we will wait for only you, 'cause all we want is you.
We will wait for you.
Yes, God, we're waiting on you.
'Cause all we want.
2021 wasn't good for a whole lot of people. But we're going to wait on you, because a change is going to come.
Because
all we want is you. Lord, we wait on you.
We wait for you.
All we want.
All we want is
just a touch from the Master's hand.
We will wait.
Because we need you right now. Is praying out here for a change to come in your life. We're praying praying for our children, praying for this nation. Hey, we're praying. God, we need you today. We lift our hearts, we are praying. I can't stop praying because you've done it before. I'm still praying because you've been, oh. We're praying, sowing. We need you. We need you. We need you. We need you. Somebody say, we need you. Open your mouth, somebody. We need you. Come on, if you need him today.
We need you.
We need you.
We need you.
Hey, we need you. We need you. Listen, I need you. Oh, I need thee. Thank you, Lord, today. Every hour. Oh, I lift my hands and say I sure do need you. Oh, not my mama prayers. Probably know that song. Come on, help us sing. In the name.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Tell them, Satan, you have to flee. Victory, come on, say, I got the victory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We bless your name, God.
Our Father and our God, we are so grateful for you, for just your peace and God, your presence. And so, Lord, we come now on the precipice of this new year, just leaning and depending on you and you alone. And so, Father, we just pray that you would continue to be the God that you've been in 2021. You've been faithful, you've covered us, you've kept us, you've provided for us, and for that we say thank you. But Lord, as we are preparing for this new year, we are asking for you to send the rain. Lord, in so many ways, we've been praying and waiting and We know that you've heard our prayers, and we know that you are still yet working. And so, Father, even now we will trust you. So now, Lord, as we come to your holy word, I pray that you would speak to us clearly. Give us a word, Lord, that we can hold on to as we move into this upcoming year. Father, we bless your name. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. Come on, give God a praise if you don't mind. I really feel like just laying in the floor right now, but I think I need to share just a little bit of this word with you, and then we're going to close in a special way tonight. What a sweet spirit is in this place, and I know, you know, there's so much concern around Omicron, and I know that a large number of people have opted to not have service or not attend service in person, and so whether you are with us online or here in the building, I want you to know that we are grateful for you. It's an honor and a privilege that we get to worship together however we feel comfortable. Amen. Come on, give God praise. I want you to meet me in the 27th division of the Psalms, Psalm 27. Our theme for tonight is moving forward, because that's what we are endeavoring to do. When I think about this past year and really these 18 to 21 months or so, depending on when you start tracking COVID, I think about the songwriter that said, through many dangers, toils, and snares. You know, God has, he's been faithful to us and he's brought us. And as I thought about what it meant to move into this year and sought God on this as we were preparing and praying for this service, we felt like we needed to lean into what the Lord was saying about how moving forward and making progress requires change. We've been through so much change, and it's easy to think through all of the changes that God is not working. But in fact, God is working. And so tonight, through laughter and through worship and even through the word of God, our goal has been to prepare you to move forward by understanding the process of change, the word of change, the power in change. And then finally, I want to talk for a few moments about the confidence that we can have even in this change. In Psalm 27, David says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle, he shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock, and now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore, I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You've been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take care of me. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in the smooth path because of my enemies. Do not deliver me to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and such breathe out violence." Here's our key verse. "I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." As we prepare to move into this new year, with everything that we've been through, I'm here to tell you that we can be confident, even in the midst of all of these changes. This is one of my favorite psalms, and there are several psalms that I love, but this one in particular, through this pandemic and through all of the changes that have come with it, I have found extra special meaning. There's so much in this psalm, particularly the context and background of this psalm is important, because when David writes this psalm, he's moving forward, but he's also experiencing lots of change. He is not yet the new king of Israel, but he has been appointed and selected and even anointed by Samuel to be the new king. And so David is in the process of change. But what he realizes and what we all should recognize is that change also comes with challenges. See, at the time of writing this psalm, David is being hunted by Saul and his men. When David writes this psalm, David is in a Judean wilderness and he's hiding because Saul and his men are built on finding David and killing him. This is why in verse 2, David says, when wicked men advance against me to devour me. He's talking about the fact that they are trying to find him in this wilderness to take him out. But not only that, he also says in verse 12, don't turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. He's saying that not only are they trying to kill him, but he's also being lied on and mischaracterized. But what I want you to see, and what I hope you don't miss, is that just like we see in David's life, we also should understand about our life, and that is when we move forward, moving forward comes with challenges. And I believe that this is particularly important because what I recognize is that many of us only have a faith for good times. When things are lining up, when things are going the way we want them to go, when everything is easy and peaceful and perfect, we have a faith for that. But when challenges and difficulties come, often we don't have a theology for that. We struggle to find God in the midst of challenges. We strain to understand why in the world would God allow bad things to happen to good people. And I think in many ways that we forget, or perhaps we just were never aware in the first place of what Psalm 34 and 19 clearly teaches us when it says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us from them all. That's a significant verse because what it helps us understand is that faith in God doesn't spare us from difficulties. But our faith does equip us to live with confidence and hope and courage despite the difficulties and the challenges. Things are changing for David, and he faces two things. He faces a blessed future, but he also faces an unknown future. And that's the same for us as we stand on the precipice of this new year. I know that our new year will be blessed because I know that the master is up to good concerning us. I take comfort in verses like Jeremiah 29 and 11 when he says, in the midst of change and challenges, but I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future, because there is a blessed future that God has for us. But at the same time, it's also an unknown future. We don't know everything that we're going to encounter in January and in February and in March and in April and May and June and July and August and September and October and November and even in next December. We don't know all the nuances and the details about what's going to come our way. But what's so powerful about this psalm that I want to share with you in just a few minutes is that in this psalm, despite the challenges, despite facing a blessed and an unknown future, David shows us how we can move forward with confidence in the midst of change. The first thing that David shows us, number one, is how to have confidence in the face of challenging circumstances. What I love about David is real.
David doesn't close his eyes or ignore what's happening around him, but instead, he makes a conscious decision to look at those challenging circumstances from heaven's point of view. What do you mean, heaven's point of view? In Hebrews 12, in the B clause of verse 1, it says that we have to run this race with endurance. That's set before us. But then it tells us how to do it. Looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. When it says that Jesus is the author, it means that he was before the beginning began. And he's already started this process for us. And then when it says that he is the finisher, it means that he has gone ahead of us and has already worked out what we are going to encounter. So when Hebrews 12 tells us to look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, it's telling us to remember that Jesus is Alpha and the Omega. It's telling us to remember that he who began a great work in us will see it through to completion to the day of Christ Jesus. It's telling us to remember that there are no challenging circumstances in our lives, in our present or in our future, that will be a surprise to God. We won't get into something next year and God will say, oh, you know what? I didn't consider that. We won't encounter challenges in this upcoming year and God will be up in heaven scratching his head saying, man, I hope they can make it through that. No, because he's already gone ahead of us. And when you look at your circumstance through the lens of heaven, from heaven's point of view, you can take comfort in the fact that it may be a surprise to you, but it's not a surprise to God. And he's already worked it out. So when David is looking at things from heaven's point of view, even in the midst of these challenging circumstances with people trying to kill him, he knows that God has an answer for his challenging stuff. See, as we move into this new year, there will be challenges. I don't know how long the Omicron is going to be around. I don't know if there'll be something after Omicron. But the reason we can be confident is because our Father is the author and finisher of our faith. The reason we can be confident is because this pandemic was not a surprise to God, and he's already gone ahead of us, and there's life after this. There's blessing after this. See, David realized that in light of God going ahead of him, it also meant that all he needed was the Lord to move forward. He recognized that the Lord was everything that he needed to move forward. This is why David starts the psalm and David says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? What David is literally saying is, well, God is my light, so I don't have to worry about darkness. He's my strength, so I don't need to fear the times when I'm at my weakest. And as a matter of fact, the word reminds us that his strength is made perfect in our weakness. He's saying he is my salvation, which means when the battle is raging and when I don't know whether or not I'm going to come out of this thing, I can remember that, wait a minute, our victory is assured in Jesus. This is another reason why, y'all, we can be confident in the face of challenging circumstances. Because we can know for certain that no matter how dark things get, God is going to be our light. We can know for certain that no matter when we go through seasons of weakness and confusion, that he's going to be our strength. We can be certain that no matter how great the opposition is or where the attack comes from, that God is always going to be our salvation. This is why I love it in verse 2 and 3. David says, when the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and my foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart, I love it, shall not fear. The war rise against me, in this I will be confident. He's saying, it doesn't matter what's going on around me. I can be confident. And I love it because David, honestly, y'all, did not know where the next attack was going to come from. He had no idea. He didn't know how Saul and his army was going to come at him. He didn't know if it was going to be a sneak attack. They were just going to create an ambush and he was going to walk into it. He didn't know if they were going to lay siege and have a long battle. But it didn't matter because David knew that God was with him. And that's a word for us. That's a word for us. I know there will be attacks of the enemy next year. And I don't mean this to be doom and gloom, but we know that that's what the enemy does. We know that his desire is to steal, kill, and destroy. But no matter what the attack is, no matter where it comes from, the word of God for us that we can take comfort in and be confident in is that God is with us. God is with us. I remember I was preaching in South Africa. And I remember that was really my first time. I was there actually with one of my mentors, one of the apostolic elders of this church, Bishop Kenneth Omer. And I remember that he said, I want you to come along with me. Let's go to South Africa. We have churches over there that we help to oversee and pastors that we pour into. And he says, you know, and we're going to do some leadership teaching and pull some pastors together. And, you know, he's one of my preaching heroes. And I'd never been on the stage with him and shared that kind of preaching platform. And he preached and taught. And I mean, it was nothing left. And then he sat down and then gave the mic to me. And I'm thinking, why are you giving the mic to me? You have already done it. And I began to share what God had put on my heart. And there was just a wave of God's glory that swept in that place. And I'll never forget, after we finished, he came up to me and he said, son, the Lord is with you. He said, whatever you go through, don't ever forget, God is with you. And I've never forgotten that to this very day. And I say that, I declare that over your life as we get ready to step into this new year. I cannot tell you everything that we are going to encounter, but I'm here to declare that the Lord is with you. And the truth of the matter is, if God be for us, who can be against us? See, part of the secret to David's public confidence was his private worship. I love it. He took time. He was intentional about worshiping and fellowshipping with God, even in a Judean wilderness. He is in the wilderness, y'all. He doesn't have a nice sanctuary. He doesn't have a nice home at this particular moment. He is physically away from the sanctuary, physically away from his home. But even in the midst of a wilderness, he's still able to press into the presence of the Lord through worship. And that's good for us, because whether you decide to worship online or come into the building masked up and Lysoled up and everything that we do to stay safe, it doesn't really matter where you worship. But what's going to matter as we go into this new year is that you prioritize worship, that you prioritize daily spending time with God, getting into the presence of God. This is why David says, one thing that I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Ah, I love it. To behold the beauty of the Lord and inquire in his temple. Watch this. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. Thank you, Lord. In the secret place of his tabernacle, he shall hide me and set me high upon a rock. Now, that's a huge statement right there. We can't run past that too quickly, because remember, David doesn't have shelter. He's in a Judean wilderness running for his life. I don't know. The text doesn't tell us if it's raining or snowing, blazing hot. But what I do know is that David didn't have time to go by Dick's Sporting Goods or Urban Outfitters to get what he needed to handle the weather. He is exposed. No food, no shelter. The only clothes he has are the clothes on his back. Yet he says that when he worships, that God hides him in the shelter of his tent. Translation, when you worship, the presence of God will provide provision and peace in the midst of problems. Oh, God, thank you. Oh, when I look back on this year, I can tell you that there have been some challenging times, but when I get in my car, or get in my office, or have my quiet time with the Lord and do my soap devotion in the morning, if I can just have my worship time, oh, I'm transported away from the drama, and I'm safe in the shelter of the Lord. See, the image here, Hebrew is a language of pictures. Greek is a language of definitions. And the image here that David is pointing to is that worship and time with God, it centers you, it focuses you, it gives you clarity in the midst of chaos. It means that there could be chaos all around you. It's kind of like when I'm at home in my office and I'm working and the kids are in the living room and they're doing all of their stuff and they're watching TV and watching movies and they got the TV real loud. What I do is I have my noise canceling headphones that I put on, and it's loud and chaotic, but when I put those headphones on, I can't hear anything and I'm in peace places. Do you hear what I'm trying to teach you? That David is saying that there can be all kind of chaos and havoc going on around you, but worship is like the noise-canceling headphones. The worship and time with God allows you to just slip into a place of peace where you can hear God and be renewed and refreshed. Hallelujah. David says, I can be confident. You and I can have confidence in the midst of challenges. But here's the second thing he says. He says we can have confidence in the face of an unknown future. Oh, I need this word. Thank you, Lord. David is in the wilderness. He's on the run for his life, and he doesn't know what the future is going to hold. He doesn't know if tomorrow he's going to see them. He's going to have to take off running in another direction. He doesn't know if he's going to walk out, and they got an ambush set up for him. He's facing an unknown future. But check out what David says in verse 13. Let's drop all the way down to verse 13. See, when you study the Psalms, there's a Hebraic kind of way that the Psalms are written in literature, and it's not written in a linear fashion. It's written kind of in a circular fashion. And so drop down to verse 13, because David says this. David says, I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Another translation says, I almost fainted. Another translation says it like this. I almost gave up. I almost threw in the towel. I almost raised my hand and say, you know what? You can have this marriage. You can have this job. He says, I was almost done. He's saying that in the face of an unknown future, he almost gave up. And I'm preaching to somebody, whether you are online or in this building, that describes this past year. You've gone through seasons when you were like, God, I'm tired. I'm done. I've tried and it didn't turn out the way I wanted it to turn out. And I'm through. Lord knows I know how that feels. There are some days that I'm like, God, what did I do to deserve this? There are days that I've had conversations with the Lord saying, Lord, I did everything that you asked me to do and I tried. And God, I don't understand why this is the outcome. But David says, watch this. He says, I would have lost heart. I almost fainted. I was getting ready to throw in the towel. But I believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Not pie in the sky by and by when we get to heaven and we're going to put on a robe and you're going to have a robe and I'm going to have a robe. He says, no. He says, almost fainted, almost gave up, almost threw in the towel. And I would have, he says, unless I believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. We got to break that word down. That word believe means to be confident. It means to be firm. It means to be sure, secure. I told you Hebrew is a language of pictures. And so the word picture here, when he says that I almost fainted, if I had not believed, that the word picture here is a picture of a baby going to their parents with their arms up, knowing that their parents are going to pick them up. What David is saying is that I would have lost heart. I would have given up, almost threw in the towel, but I believe, I'm confident, I'm sure that when I go to my Heavenly Father with my hands up, he's going to pick me up. Can I tell you something? What the enemy is after more than your car and your job, he's after your belief. The enemy wants you, and he has been trying through this last year to get you to a place where you literally say, God, I just don't believe that you're going to come through anymore. I don't believe that you're going to fix my marriage. I don't believe that you're going to turn this situation around. So let me just pack up and go to another city or go to another industry or go to another church or go to another situation because I just don't believe that anything is going to change. My family's been this way all this time, and I don't think that I'm going to be any different, and I've tried everything, and I can't get this together, and I can't fix this together. What the enemy has been after is he's been after your belief. He's trying to get you to a place where you say, God, I just don't believe that change will come. I don't believe that anything will get any different or get better. But I'm here to tell you, I don't know what the future holds, but I do know who holds the future. And the same God who holds the future, here's what I'm here to tell you, will pick us up and hold us whenever we find ourselves in trouble. I'm here to tell you that your Heavenly Father loves you so much that when your arms are raised, he scoops down and picks you up. I'm here to tell you that all you've got to do is believe and hold on to that belief. In other words, David says, I really know too much about the goodness of the Lord that you're not going to make me doubt God's goodness. He's saying this in the midst of a wilderness where people are attacking him. Where all of this impending doom and disaster is around him. He says, but I just know too much about the goodness of God. And I just know too much about the goodness of God that I'm not going to doubt that somehow, some way, God's going to come through. I'm teaching to increase your faith tonight. Because that's got to be your mantra. Somehow, some way, God's going to bring me through this. Somehow, some way, God's going to work this thing out for my good. How did David have this belief? Well, remember, David is the author of several Psalms. And for an example, in Psalm 23 and verse 6, it tells us literally that the goodness of the Lord follows us. David says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. In Psalm 21 and verse 3, he tells us that God's goodness is literally waiting on us. He says, for you meet him with the blessings of goodness. You set a crown of pure gold upon his head. In Psalm 31 and 19, it tells us that God has stored up goodness for us. It says, oh, how great is your goodness, which you've laid up for those who fear you. Psalm 52 and 1 tells us that the goodness of God, God, I love your word, it never runs out. It says, why do you boast so, O evil, almighty man? The goodness of God endures continually. Psalm 65 and 4 tells us that when we worship God and enter into his presence, we can receive all of the goodness that we need. It says, blessed is the man you choose and cause to approach you, that he may dwell in your courts, be satisfied by the goodness of your house, of your holy temple. So David says, I know too much about the goodness of God. I know the goodness of God is following me. I know the goodness of God is waiting and stored up for me. I know the goodness of God never runs out. I know that when I need more goodness, I can enter into his presence and worship, and I can receive all of the goodness that I need. David says, I know, I believe, I'm confident that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Why? Because it's following me. It's waiting for me. It's stored up for me. When I enter into the presence of the Lord, he'll give me even more goodness. I'm trying to teach to somebody up in here. The reason you can hang on and say, wait a minute, somehow, some way, God is going to work this out is because there's goodness that's following you. There's goodness that is waiting on you. There is goodness that he stored up for you. There's goodness when you enter his presence that he will give you, and the goodness of the Lord never runs out. This is why we can be confident, y'all, in the face of an unknown future. This is why in the very next verse, David says, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. David is saying, even though it didn't happen, maybe some things you were hoping didn't happen in this year, wait on the Lord. Because when you know that he's got goodness in store for you, when you know that he is up to good concerning you, he says, in other words, as you move into this new year, this is not the time to worry about being driven. This is more so the time to be led. Because wait on God. Wait. Don't become impatient. Don't try to make things happen. Because what we do when we feel like things are not happening on our timetable is, what do? We try to make it happen. We try to force God's hand. Sometimes out of anxiousness and anxiety, we feel like, well, nothing's happening, so I got to move. David says, don't do it. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Wait, and that's a word for somebody tonight. Wait on him. Wait on him in your marriage. Wait on him. When is the last time that you said, Lord, before I make this decision, I want to make sure that I hear clearly from you? When is the last time before the opportunity was there? Just because it's a good opportunity doesn't mean it's a God opportunity. When's the last time that the door of opportunity opened that you said, before I step through, I gotta wait to see, is this what God wants for me? I love the Passion Translation of this text. I love it. It says in the same verse, here's what I've learned through it all. Don't give up. Don't be impatient. Don't be impatient. You know, and this is, I feel Holy Spirit saying this. This is totally off topic. But one of the things that we got to remember, y'all, is that God doesn't operate on our time frame. That's a word for somebody. Because the world is all about, it's got to move here, microwave this and microwave that and fast food this and fast food that. And sometimes we take that same mentality and apply it to God and then have the nerve to get mad and say, why aren't you moving quick enough? God says, no, I got something else concerning you. I got good that I'm going to do, but I also want to make sure that you are ready for what I'm trying to bring you into. This is not just about where I'm taking you, it's about what I'm trying to do in you. It says, don't give up. Don't be impatient. Be entwined as one with the Lord. Be brave and courageous. Never lose hope. Yes, keep on waiting, for he will never disappoint you. And can I tell you, when I look back over this tumultuous year, I'm filled with more gratitude than anything else. Because has it been a challenge? Yes. But can I tell you something? God's never disappointed. When I look back over my life, over this year and the years prior and my whole life, I see God's handiwork. He's never disappointed. He's never let me down. I understand now in a greater way what my grandmother meant when she said, baby, if I had 10,000 hands and 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough, because he's been so good. Because he's never let me down. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging bread. Oh, he's never let me down. And David says, he won't disappoint you. He says, this is why you can have confidence in the face of challenges. This is why you can have confidence in the face of an unknown future. But then lastly, he says, but all of it is contingent upon us having confidence in the face of God. See, what I love about this passage is David knew that the most important part of his life was that part that only God could see. Not the stuff we put on social media. Not the outfit we wear when we know we're going to be on the stage. David recognized, even in the midst of these challenges, that the most important part of his life was the part that only God could see, and he would not compromise that. David knew that the foundation of his confidence with challenges and with an unknown future was his relationship with God. And he literally is saying, God, as long as I am good with you, as long as I'm holy and pure and acceptable before God, then God, I know that you will take care of everything else. The Bible says that there is no good thing that he'll withhold from those who walk uprightly. I don't anticipate getting any amens right in through here, because we will shout about God, give us this and God, give us that. When is the last time we said, God, I just want to be right before you? When is the last time that we cried out like David, God, I want to make sure that I get this right. I want to make sure, God, that I don't disappoint you. I want to make sure, God, that if nobody else is pleased, that you are pleased. This is why David said in verse 7, hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, seek my face. So watch this. David is in this drama, in this Judean wilderness. People are trying to kill him. And he's like, God, what are we going to do? God, Omicron, before Omicron was Delta, I don't know if Zeta, whatever's coming next, what are we going to do? God says to David, seek my face. And David says, your face, Lord, will I seek. See, when the Bible talks about the face of God, it goes all the way back to the Levitical blessing that the priest were called to give over the people in Numbers, you know. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. When the face of the Lord shined upon us, shined upon the people, it meant God was pleased with them. And then David says, don't hide your face from me, because when God would hide his face, it would mean that he wasn't pleased. When God's face would shine upon you, the shining of God's face upon you would bring favor, would bring blessing. would bring everything that you would need. David says, here's what I want to make sure, God. I want to make sure that in the haste and in the challenges and in everything that I'm going through, that I want to make sure that you and I are good. Because if I'm right and holy and pleasing and acceptable to you, I know that you'll make your face shine upon me. And when your face shines upon me, then I'll get favor. I'll get blessing. I'll get promotion. I'll get opportunity. And I'm here to tell you tonight, what you need in this new year more than man's approval is you need God's approval. When is the last time that we cried out, God, I just want your face to shine upon me. I want your face to shine upon my family. I want your face to shine upon my marriage. When is the last time that our prayer was not for God to give us anything, but God, search our heart. Make sure that we are right before you. That's the way we want to enter into this new year. Because I know that there have been things that we've all experienced this year. There have been difficulties. There have been heartaches. There have been disappointments. There have been letdowns. There have been all kinds of changes. And what the enemy wants more than anything else is he wants to use those things to take a root of bitterness and resentment and all of that kind of junk to happen in your heart. Because he knows that if you are not where you need to be internally with God, then you'll miss what God has for you. See, the enemy can't do anything about your future. He knows that it's secure, but he can disqualify you or get you to disqualify yourself so that you can't access the future that God has for you. And I want to ask you this question tonight. When is the last time that you were still before the Lord and said, God, search my heart. I want your face. But I want to make sure, God, that there's nothing in me that I haven't confessed. There's nothing in me that I haven't dealt with. Because I know that there's some things, God, that I cannot take into this new year. There's some hurt. There's some stuff I've been holding on to that I cannot hold on to. I've seen too many people miss God and disqualified from their very best because they keep holding on to the wrong stuff. So I want to encourage you tonight to just make an altar. If you're watching us online, in your home, in your bedroom, to just make an altar right wherever you are in this sanctuary. Maybe you want to make an altar right where you are. Maybe you want to turn your seat into an altar. Maybe you want to come to this altar and socially distance. Maybe you want to get into a corner of this room. But I beg you, let those who have an ear hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the church. Let's make sure that our hearts are right. Let's make sure, listen to me, that whatever we've been carrying, because some of you have been carrying some heavy things. And here's what the Lord told me to tell you. Tonight, whether you come to this altar or whether you make an altar right where you are, take it off. Leave it. Lay it down and leave it. Let me give it to you again. Take it off. Lay it down and leave it. Take it off. Lay it down and leave it. It will not serve you in this new season. Take it off. Lay it down and leave it. And so wherever you are in this room, I want to give you space to do that right now. Make an altar wherever you are. You want to come to this altar, if you want to kneel right where you are, online family, make an altar wherever you are. If you're in your car getting ready to go to your New Year's Eve party, just turn the music off and just sit in your car and just make that car your altar. Be honest about some of the stuff that you've been carrying. That God says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you. For I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. Take it off. Lay it down. And leave it.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well?
Take my hand,
what's born with
precious blood.
back, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
To lay it down and to leave it here. As we prepare to move into this new year, God, we want to do it by your grace and by your favor. So, Lord, have your way in our life. Father, I pray for every person under the sound of my voice that doesn't know you, that needs to open their heart to receive you tonight. I pray for every person under the sound of my voice that may know you as Savior, but they don't have a faith community. They're doing life by themselves. Father, I pray for every person under the sound of my voice that those circumstances and challenges that I was talking about earlier, they push them away from you, push them away from the people of God. They sense, God, that you're drawing them back. I pray tonight, Lord, that decisions would be made to say yes to you and your will right now in the name of Jesus. And I thank you by faith, Lord, for every decision in this room, around the world. I thank you, Father, for every decision that's being made in this moment. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said, amen. Now listen, Pastor Michelle at the top of our service pointed out the QR code. They'll put that graphic back up on the screen for our online campus. Those of you that are in the sanctuary, that QR code is on the back of the seat, so you should be facing it. If you know that God is calling you to make a decision tonight, you can use that QR code. It'll take you to a discreet online form. Fill it out. Let us know. Our ministry team is standing by waiting to connect with you. We want to walk you through your next steps. We want to welcome you into the family of faith. We want to make sure that you are equipped and built up and loved on, even in a pandemic, to live your best life with Jesus. And then also, I want to encourage every person in this room tonight, those watching us online, I want you to get a seat, and I want to encourage you to sow a seed tonight. I want to encourage you to give. This is the last opportunity in this year, and I believe in seed sowing. So much of my life, I'm walking in the harvest of seeds that I've sown. And I want to encourage you to sow a seed tonight. It's just a way of saying, God, thank you that we made it through 2021. And we're looking with expectation to what you have in 2022. But let me also say something to TWC family. At the end of the year, we always give big. We always make a difference in a radical way. And I talk to you about the fact that there are churches in the state of Alabama that are facing foreclosure. And I ask you to sow a seed to help us to not only make a difference in the lives of those young people and those organizations, but also these churches. Well, I'm happy to announce that because of your generosity, just earlier today, we were able to save our first church from foreclosure. Amen. We were able to slide in there, and the bank said, if we don't get the money by the end of this year, we're going to foreclose on this church. And because of your generosity, we were able to step in and say, hey, we got them. And so I want to thank you, TWC, for your generosity, your tithing, your faithfulness, because we're making a difference in a big way. Now in January, we're going to try to help another church. And so I want you to sow something and know that as you give, watch, God will give it back to you. But he won't give it back to you the way that you gave it to him. He'll give it back to you pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the decisions that are being made. I thank you for the gifts that are being sown now. And I thank you for using us as a faith community to make a difference in the life of other believers and other churches. We thank you for it now. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said, amen.
Amen. Our ushers are coming. They're going to get in position. Listen, normally we would bring in the new year.
Wow. Welcome back to Talk Back, family. Thank you for joining us. We are just anxious to hear about your aha moments, your takeaways from today's message. I mean, what a tremendous time we've had in worship.
Magnificent.
And with this word on today, my God. Family, go ahead and type in the chat where you've been watching us from, what your takeaways were, how you're going to implement today's word in your life going forward. We would love to know about it. Pastor Janice, what were some of your takeaways from the message on today?
Oh, my God. They're phenomenal. First of all, my Redeemer lives. That just took me to a place to all I wanted to do during the service is worship. I didn't want the worship to stop today. Song after song after song, praise and worship, praise and worship. It just moved me to a place. And then you can even see it in the sanctuary with everybody having that openness to want to worship God and praise Him, thanking Him just unrelentlessly and not caring about how anybody is looking at them or what they're thinking and just feeling free to worship. That was my first takeaway. And our wonderful group Virtue, they had me, like the gentleman would say, she had me at hello. Well, they had me at my Redeemer lives. That song just touched my spirit so deeply. I didn't want to leave that place of worship, Pastor Joy.
They are so anointed, beautiful group of women. I've been following them for a while now, but they said that this is their first performance since 2020, and so we were blessed to actually have them here with us on today.
And one of the ladies actually lives in Hoover.
Yes.
I was shocked.
Unbeknownst to us.
We have celebrities right here in our surrounding areas of Birmingham. How about that?
Yes, but tremendous worship from our praise and worship team as well. My God, they just took us to another level in the spirit. So refreshing.
To 10. The ladies took us to 10 tonight. We thank them so much for being a blessing to us at the worship center. We hope you guys were blessed as well. Please comment in the chat and let us know how you felt about their worship and how they ushered in the Holy Spirit today.
Yes.
There's so much going on here that we don't want to miss out on anything. But Bishop's, his message was off the chain. It was awesome. Just what we needed as we end this season of 2021 going into 2022.
Absolutely.
To know that all we need to do is to focus on God and who He is. The things that He, like David said, he sought the Lord. And the Lord answered him. The Lord delivered him from his enemies. And we all go through these situations and these struggles and these trying times in life.
Well,
and it alone, broken, misunderstood, misused. And we need a place of where we can be restored, where we can come into the body of Christ and know that God has a plan for us and that He will never leave us nor forsake us. And David is the epitome of a biblical example of what that looks like. And we should learn from what we know about David according to what the word says. And he said something about we shouldn't wait to be driven, but we should be looking forward to being led.
Absolutely. That was an eye-opener.
Yes, it
was. You know, another thing he said was that God is with us. That's why David had that confidence, because he know that God is with him. He is Emmanuel.
Yes.
Family, we are never alone. We're never alone. Even
never
alone. When you're physically by yourself, you're never alone, because God is Emmanuel. He is with us. And that's the confidence that we walk in, and the confidence that we have.
Yes.
So what are some takeaways for today? I see Golden Tiger says, amen. God, I thank you for blessing me and my life.
Mm.
Glory to God.
Glory to God.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's
Hallelujah.
A blessing. Another takeaway I got from the message today is when Bishop Van started to talk about how, you know, in the midst of what we're going through, that worship creates an oasis for us. In the midst of it, so we can be in that shelter, we can hide, you know, we can abide in God in the midst of what's going on around us.
Yes, and Pastor Joy, when he said that, I was like, I kind of operate in that mode, kind of like on the daily, and it's not a place that you just jump into and that you're there. It comes after spending time with God, going through the trials and the tribulations, the accusations, the curses that the enemy wants to send your way, all those type of things that would discourage you from being the person that God has called you to be. Now, Pastor Joy, I was also curious to ask you, in terms of all of the different takeaways that took place in the sanctuary today, which one just resounded in you that it just settles in your spirit to know that if you walk in that or communicate that to someone else, what would that be? What would you say?
It probably would be what I've already said, is that we're never alone.
Never alone.
We're never alone. God is with us in our mountaintop experiences and even in our valley experiences as well. So we're never alone. And I think that that brings me some sort of comfort, knowing that I'm not in this by myself. You know, even though we may have some uncertainty about what tomorrow may hold, but just like Bishop says, we know who holds tomorrow. So that would be one of my key takeaways. So we got some people in the chat.
Oh, wow.
I see Minister Lakeisha. She has said, what stuck out to me is that David wrote Psalm because he believed that the Lord is my light, so I don't have to worry about darkness.
Ooh.
That was good.
Ooh, that's rich. Minister Lakeisha.
It is.
Very rich.
There's another from Alicia Frederick. We see you, Alicia. You said that keep on believing in God and wait on the Lord.
Wait on the Lord. That's it right there. Wait on the Lord. Whatever you're going through, don't rush God. Let God take you through the process as he did David. He allowed David to go through the valleys and the peaks and the peaks and the valleys. He also allowed Job to go through his suffering, and then he brought Job out of his suffering. He blessed him double for everything that he had gone through. Even with David, David was hiding in caves and right. thought about killing Saul when Saul and his men were trying to kill him, and he delivered David from that. Even Paul with the thorn in his yes. flesh, God allowed him to have the thorn in his flesh to humble him. He does those things to bring us into closer relationship with him to know that he is with us, just as Bishop said, and
right.
just as Pastor Joy reiterated, God is with us. It's the short and the sweet of it.
Amen. There are several of you in the chat, and I'm glad to have you in here. Renewed says, what a powerful word. The word was powerful. PJ says, all I need is God. Hallelujah. Singing praises to my awesome Lord and Savior. And Renewed also says, it spoke directly to my spirit. I believe, and I am I believe, amen. And
amen.
She says, oh, I'm laying my concerns down, trusting and waiting on the Lord.
Ooh,
family, we've
yes.
had just a blessed time on today. Listen, we
yes,
don't want to forget
have.
About Marcus Wiley, comedian Marcus
oh,
Wiley.
He was awesome.
Hilarious.
Yes.
He was hilarious. Thank you, Mr. Wiley, for coming out and visiting with us on today, providing that image. Entertainment, you know, it's okay
yes.
to laugh in church. The Bible tells us that laughter is good for the soul.
It is. He had us in stitches. And we know that there's some of you all out there who would enjoy a call from the prayer team, that you may be in need of prayer this evening. If you are interested in prayer, please dial our number
yes.
at 1-833-789-2543. Again, that is 1-833-789-2543.
Family, we're going to get ready to wrap it up right now. Thank you for chatting with us on today. Make sure you come back and visit with us on the pre-show for Sunday morning. We're looking forward to talking with you on Sunday morning. You guys stay safe.
Yes.
And happy New Year to you. We love you. Enjoy
love
your families. Stay safe this holiday season. And welcome to 2022. We love you, family.
We love you guys so much. Please join us on Sunday.
Clear?